Thank you very much for the nice introduction, Raphael, and thank you very much for you, Patricia and Mario, for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to present some of my work here. So having said that, I'm not going to present too much of my work. I'm going to present the work of a whole group of people here in Switzerland. So I'm using this opportunity to report a little bit from a larger research project that we got from the Swiss Science Foundation. So it will be about emerging lessons from half a century of fiscal federalism in Switzerland. And this is not, to make that clear at the beginning, not because fiscal federalism is only half a century old, but this is the scope of the data that we are using at the moment. So there is also scope to go back further. So a brief outline of what I'm going to talk about today. I will report a little bit from this SNF grant that we have, who's involved and what we're doing. Then I will show stylized facts about Switzerland that you might know, many of you might already know, but there might be some surprising new details, in particular when it comes to the evolution. So some of these data, it's the first time that we presented to a larger audience. Then I will talk a little bit about how we collected this data. This is in particular Raphael, who did that. As I said, the evolution, and then I will report from 8 examples of research projects that have been done from various team members during the last 6 years using these data. So these will be very brief glimpses on research pieces, on the questions that we seek to answer, and the results. Okay, so what is this research project about? It's called the Swiss Confederation, a natural laboratory for research on fiscal and political decentralization. It's a research project that started in 2010 and runs until the end of this year. There were 4 main applicants: Mario Sprühlhardt from Lausanne, Monica Büttler from St. Gallen, Mario Giametti from here, Lugano, and myself. There are 6 universities which are involved in this research project. So as I said, Lausanne, Basel, then Lugano and St. Gallen, but also the ETH Zurich. And because this is the place where I was when we started this project at Università Pompeo Fabra, but also other people like Patricia who were involved from there. Other key figures here, if you look at these projects, we have 36 actually senior researchers that participate in one or several of these projects. We employed 4 postdocs during this period. We also employed 9 PhD students, but there were many more PhD students involved in the project by presenting their work in one of our now 6 yearly workshops. So 26 such PhD students. And we have 1 website. And if you haven't yet visited that, it might be an interesting place to get more information. So this is about Switzerland as a laboratory. As Raphael already said, the Scandinavian countries have wonderful data on people. Switzerland does not have such nice data about people, but we have a lot of nice variation in institutions. And this is what this project is trying to exploit. Now, it's in particular institution about decentralization. So what you see here is a map of Switzerland. You see it's divided into 26 cantons, you know that, but we can further divide that into now 2,500 municipalities, and all these municipalities have a large degree of autonomy. And I will show you in what that results when it comes to the data. So this is the kind of variation that we want to exploit, that on a very small geographic area, we have lots of institutional variation. Let me just give you some key figures why one of these variations, which is very important, is decentralization of taxes. So Switzerland taxes people from the Federation at the 26 cantons in these 2,500 municipalities, and actually this affects most tax bases. So whether it's taxing households, taxing firms. Just let me give you a few key figures here. 54% of total tax revenue in Switzerland comes from one of these sub-central units, so either the canton or the municipalities, so it's more than half. 82% of household tax revenue, so this is, for example, the income tax, comes from sub-central units. When it comes to wealth tax, and I'm going to show you a piece of research on wealth taxation in Switzerland, it's 100%. So there's no federal tax on wealth, which is a problem for acquiring data, by the way. We have 100% of inheritance tax revenue, which comes from the cantons and municipalities, but also for firms, it's more than half that comes from sub-central levels. We can also go a level more below, which is the municipality, but this also has a fair share. So a third of tax revenue total comes from municipality, and also a third when we look at just households, and 19% when it's about firms. We can also put that into perspective, comparing that with other countries, and I just take this figure of total tax revenue. This is numbers for 2014. If I look at other countries, I have to go a little bit far back. So 2013 is the year where the OECD provides more data. So what you can see here is a ranking of countries by the degree of decentralization to state and local levels, and what you see on top is Canada. And then followed by Switzerland, and both about 54-55%. And it goes down, Germany, United States, one of the well-known decentralized countries or federalist countries, is already below Switzerland. And you can go down to countries like the Czech Republic, where decentralization does not play a big role. Now, what you see here is the ranking to actually either municipal or state in Switzerland, the canton level. We also collected information about how important is the municipal level. This is where we have even more variation because we have these 2,500 units in Switzerland. So this is a graph from an article in the handbook of regional and urban economics that I did together with Mario Sprühlhardt and Sam Bukovetsky. And let me quickly explain this graph. So this illustrates how important municipal taxation is in different countries, in particular Switzerland. So what you have on the horizontal axis is the local tax share, so how much of total tax revenue comes from municipalities. Now, the number is smaller than what I've just shown you, and this is because here in these dark countries, at least, we only consider autonomous tax revenue, so tax revenue where the country really has some say, or the municipality has some say, over either the taxpayer or the tax rate. Then what you have on the vertical axis, jurisdictional fragmentation. And this is a measure to say, actually, I mean, what you need to have real tax competition is you need autonomy, but you also need lots of these units competing with one another. So what we did here is we only look at metropolitan areas, and we actually count how metropolitan areas in different OECD countries are divided into different local units. And what you see here is if you look at such a figure, Switzerland has here a very high value, and that actually means it's on top here. Only Austria is more subdivided here. So both figures taken together, you would actually say what you really want to have a lot of competition on a local metropolitan level is you want to have lots of local tax revenue, but also lots of fragmentation. And what you see here is Switzerland is really outstanding. The example country where you have both of these dimensions to a very large degree. There are other countries where it's important, like the United States, but to a much smaller extent. You also have countries like Austria, where you do have a lot of fragmentation, but those municipalities have no say actually over tax revenue. And you have other countries like Finland, where you have lots of autonomy, actually lots of local tax revenue, but these municipalities are huge and actually covering almost the entire metropolitan area. So that's just another piece to show that Switzerland is unique in actually this kind of institution of decentralizing taxation. Good. So the next thing is I want to tell you a little bit how we collected data in this research project. So at the core of this six-year Synergia project was actually the idea to collect data to make this fruitful. The first piece of data that we wanted to collect is actually local and cantonal tax rate. Looks like this is easily available, but actually that's already was a task that took us some years. So one piece of information that we used here is digitizing actually printed average tax rates that the Federal Tax Administration collected for a few municipalities over the country, and we have that from 1970 onwards. And then this is mainly the work of Raphael Parche. Raphael was also going to the cantonal archives to find all these municipal tax multipliers, or Steuerfüße, as it's called in German, to actually extend this data that we can really cover the entire universe of municipalities, which are these now 2,500 municipalities, used to be more towards 3,000, and we have now the whole tax rates over this period. Now, tax rate is not just a number. So each canton, municipality, they have different tax schedules. So you actually need to know by household type and income, what's the average tax rate. So this is already a very big data set where we can actually say a household, married, two kids, income 100,000, what's the tax rate? What we have this all along the income distribution. The other source of information that we collected is information on tax base. So we want to actually know what is the tax base. So for example, average or total income in the municipalities, in the cantons. Now we were very lucky to actually get access at the beginning of this project, because we got the project, to individual data from the Federal Tax Administration. So the Federal Tax Administration actually installed a workstation in their offices in Bern, which is secured, and researchers from our researchers project there have access to the universe of individual tax records from the whole of Switzerland. So this allows us to actually calculate lots of aggregate measures, but also to do actually analysis on the individual level. So these are the two main data sets that we collected within that project. But there is much more. So looking at different sub-projects, people collected lots of other data, like data on other tax bases, like we have some data, but not too much yet, on corporate taxation, firm taxation. We do have data on public expenditures, and actually have this also now in a nice format, also the municipal level, the cantonal level. We have some data on fiscal and political institutions, and I will show you some of that, how we exploit that, or how people exploited that in research project. Of course, on demographics across the country and evolution of that. Real estate prices is another data that we have, not going back to 1970, unfortunately, but starting in the early 2000s, and geography. So these are travel distances, which actually change over time because of the transport infrastructure. Okay, so let me just show you a little bit how that data looks now in 2014, just visualizing that tax rate. So I said 26 cantons. What you see in the map here is like the variation in tax rate for a particular household type. This is a married couple with two kids with a high income. And actually what I show you here is a married couple with an income in the top 1% of the overall Swiss income distribution. And what you see here is, like, let's just look at the legend, is already to see the variation that can actually start from 8.9% that you have as an average tax rate, cantonal municipal taxes on top is the federal tax, but going up to 22% here, the maximum in the canton of Neuchâtel. Now, this is now just for the cantons, and I actually include the municipal tax rate. I take a weighted average over all these individual municipalities. Now, we can also look at that, looking at the municipal level, still showing the combined tax rate for cantonal and municipal tax rate. And what you see is the variation gets even bigger, because within cantons, you've got lots of differences. Now, this is all over Switzerland, and you don't see too much because it's too much information, but we can zoom into, for example, one metropolitan area. Here it's the metropolitan area of Zurich. And again, what you see is lots of variation in a small area, like just one metropolitan area, where you have average taxes or already rather high taxes in the center, then surrounded by a fringe of these very low tax municipalities. Sometimes you call that the Speckgürtel. There is less variation here. I made it a little bit more pronounced if you look at the colors, but here the variation goes from 12% to 17%. I can also visualize the other data that we have, which is the tax base, which is to say, okay, let's look now, how does the income distribution look spatially in Switzerland? And the map that you have here is just showing the canton, and what I have here is total taxable income of this canton divided by the number of inhabitants. So that includes children, babies, retired people, everybody. And these are numbers now. Again, you see lots of variation. It varies across Swiss cantons from 27,000 to 58,000. So a big variation there. But actually, this variation even gets much bigger if you look at the municipal level. So here I really had to trick a little bit with the scale. So let's just look at the legend first. So these brackets are 10,000, ranging in the middle groups from 20,000 up to, say, 80,000. But then look at the top group, that goes from 80,000 to 416,000. Swiss francs is the taxable income per inhabitant of a municipality. That's a small village in the canton de Vaud. It's Vaux-sur-Morche. So half a million is the average income taxable per resident. It's only 150 people, but you can imagine what kind of incomes are behind that number. We can also zoom in the metropolitan area of Zurich, and again, well, this is not these huge differences, but it's quite considerable. So differences in the canton of Zurich here of 22,000 up to 89,000, so a factor of four within a very small geographic area. What's more interesting is actually to put these figures together and look, so what's the relation between tax rates and tax base? And this is now the real, like the first time that I show that, we show that to a larger audience, to see that correlation, but also the evolution over time. And for that, I'm going to this graph here. So what you see here on the horizontal axis is the tax rate for a rather high income, so it's a top 10% for a married couple without children. We cannot follow the information for couples with children back to 1970, so I use this household. On the vertical axis, you've got this taxable income per capita. The size of the bubble is the size of the place, so this, for example, is Zurich. It's a large canton, lots of population. You've got another one, which is large, Bern, lower. Higher taxes, lower income. And then you've got these places like the canton of Zug, extremely high income, 53,000 per capita, but also extremely low tax rate. And look at that number, that's 4.4%. That's the combined municipal and cantonal tax rate. And then look at this small place, that's the canton of Neuchâtel, 17.4%, and about half the income. Now this is how it looks in 2012. That's the latest data point for which we have data on the tax base. Now we can go back in time, going back to 1972, and actually the picture was quite different there. So the first observation is actually that the variation in tax rate was already considerable, but smaller. So that ranges from 10% to 19%. Actually the lowest tax base, the canton of Basel-Land, you might hear the news right now, there's a canton which is quite struggling, and the top place was the canton de Valais. So you see actually already from just these, it's also the ranking has quite changed. So I want to show you now the evolution going from 1972 to 2012, which is looking at two examples. And I take the two examples, Neuchâtel on the one hand and the canton of Zug. So you see actually in 1972, these two cantons weren't too different. Well, the canton of Zug already had kind of smaller tax rate, but it wasn't too dramatic. So it's 16% in Neuchâtel for this household, it's 14.2% in Zug. If you look at actually the, I have to mark it again. If you look at income, it's also not so dramatically different. It's 9,600 in the canton of Zug. It's 7,000 in the canton of Neuchâtel, a little bit poorer, but not so dramatically. Now let's see how that evolved over 40 years of tax competition. So that's kind of a tale of two places that started not too differently, but ended up in totally different places. So what you see is actually Zug dramatically decreased tax rates, and actually what you can also see in quite some dramatic shifts. And at the same time, or usually actually not at the same time, but right after decreasing tax rates, you can actually see these spikes or these increases in the tax base going on and on. Now, this, by the way, financial crisis that took its toll on the canton of Zug here towards the very end. Neuchâtel, on the other hand, had increases in tax rates, had also increases here, this is not deflated or anything, but has much, much smaller increases in the tax base. So ending up like the canton with the highest taxes and almost the lowest income, and the canton of Zug now far apart being lowest tax rates and highest income. So what I wanted to show you is actually Switzerland not only has in the cross section a lot of variation, but it also has an evolution that's going on, which has variation which is quite dramatic, and that has the potential to be exploited to do research. To do research and actually see how do people react to these changes. And that's exactly what we wanted to do in this research project. So going back to my slides. So, what did we seek to learn in this project? Well, the first thing is simply the things that I showed you. We wanted to describe what's going on in this institution of decentralized taxation and just to produce stylized facts. But that's not the more interesting part. More interesting is actually to exploit that then to learn about people's behavior. So, a first question that we tried to answer was like, how does the tax base really react to changes in tax rate? So if a place decreases its tax rate, does this attract tax base or change the behavior of people? Okay, so that was the first one, and then we can express this as an elasticity, so elasticity of tax bases. A second interesting question is then also to look at the channels. So where does this elasticity come from? So what are the margins of response? Is it that, for example, if you have a decrease or a decrease in incomes, is it because people adjust their labor supply or because they avoid taxes or they evade taxes? Or is it the migration response? Because in Switzerland, and this is really unique, because of this difference on a very small geographic scale, we expect that people might actually avoid taxation by just going to places where taxes are lower. So the migration response potentially plays an important role, and it was part of this project to quantify that, and I will show you how we try to do that in different research projects. Another line of research is to look actually at the jurisdiction and how they behave. So tax competition. How do actually municipalities, well, in the end, it's the inhabitants of these municipalities that make the decision, but how do they react to when other municipalities and cantons make changes? And another line of research is to actually look how fiscal and political institutions influence what's going on for people and for the municipalities. So things like the debt brake or fiscal equalization schemes. So this is the type of question that we tried to answer with that project. What I'm going to show you now for the remainder of this talk is I'm going to pick 8 research projects to show you example of how we approach these questions, what kind of data we are using, what kind of tricks we are using to identify or hope to identify effects and also what we find. These are just examples, so it's not covering everything that we did, but it just shows you in 8 examples the scope of the questions that we tackle and how we do that. Okay, so I'm going to start with my own papers, not because they're more important, but because I know them best. But this is just for the first few projects. First one, that's a joint project or paper with Markus Roller, a PhD student of mine in Basel. It's called Effective Tax Rates and Effective Progressivity in a Fiscally Decentralized Country. So this first paper is actually, this is still a more descriptive paper. The research question is, as I said, people can avoid high taxes in Switzerland by moving to places where taxes are low. Different people might make this decision differently, so rich people might actually do that more often than poor people. And what we try to look at is how does this influence effective tax rates countrywide? So we want to actually look what is the tax schedule, and I will show you that in the next slide, what we mean by that, but how does progressivity or the whole tax schedule over the income range look if you look at the whole country of Switzerland, and if you consider that people spatially sort or potentially spatially sort based on tax rates. So this is really using the data that I presented you that we collected in this project. So we used the universe of confidential individual tax records from the Federal Tax Administration. So we use these individual tax records in Bern, and we actually do this for a cross-section in 2009, and then we go back in time, back to 1972. What we also use, we need the tax rates along the income range, so we use this whole data set of tax rates which Raphael collected. The method that we're using in terms of econometrics, it's a non-parametric regression, so it's a local polynomial with a kernel, and it's a very simple exercise, and the result is in the next graph, and that quite summarizes what we were doing. So what do you see here? On the horizontal axis, you see household income. Household means here, this is for an unmarried single household, no children, and you've got taxable income, so it starts at 20,000, 50,000, 100,000, then a million, 10 million, so it's a logarithmic scale to really see where the action is. But this is the whole range of taxable incomes. On the vertical axis, you see the average tax rate that these households faces in Switzerland. Now, the top line here is, this is the maximum that you might face in a municipality in Switzerland. So with an income of 300,000, your average tax rate, including the federal tax rate, that can go up to 35%. But there are also places where it's just a bit more than 10%. So this is the minimum and the maximum you can face in Switzerland. This is also the variation that you saw in this map. As you go up with income, actually, well, this can go up to almost 20%, but also over 40%. So the dash dotted line here just shows you what we would have naively done to summarize like the countrywide tax schedule, and what this line also gives you then is an idea of progressivity. So we just average these tax rates over all 2,500 municipalities. Now, of course, some municipalities are larger, city of Zurich, and other municipalities are small, Vaux-sur-Morche. So we already weighted the larger municipalities more by just weighting them by the number of inhabitants. Now this is what the line shows here, and this is continuously upward sloping. So what you see here is tax rates actually go up with income. This is what we call a progressive tax schedule. Okay, so the upward sloping, that's actually mechanical, because in Switzerland, any canton and any municipality does have such an upward sloping tax schedule, except for the canton of Obwalden for a very short period of time. So summarizing that also is upward sloping. But this does not yet consider that actually going along this whole range of income, people might not live nicely, homogeneously over the whole country. So rich people might actually be more likely to be more often in these low tax places. And this is what you see here in the line here. This line is actually the average considering where people live. So we simply take all the individuals in Switzerland, we assign the tax rate that they pay, and then we simply average that with a non-parametric regression. And what you see is actually from an income of about 300,000, it gets flat. After about a million, it even goes down. So this is what we call an effective tax rate, and actually we can show that this is even regressive for the very high incomes in Switzerland, because these households very systematically avoid high taxes by locating in low tax places. So that's one piece of research that we could only do because of this extremely rich data set that we collected in our SNF grant. Good. That's first example. Second example, that's a project together with Michaela Slotrinsky, another PhD of student of of us in Basel that you know very well since yesterday evening, I guess. This is another paper of hers, so she is doing lots of very interesting projects. This is called Behavioral Responses to Local Tax Rate, Quasi-Experimental Evidence from a Foreigner's Tax Scheme in Switzerland. What's the research question here? The research question here is whether taxpayers do respond to local tax increases by migrating to other locations. So this is a paper that directly looks at this migration margin. Do people respond to tax differential by deciding their location upon that? The data, again, uses part of the data from this project. Now here we're not using the individual data from this project because the data in Bern does not contain the information that we really need. So the individual data that we use in this project is from survey data, so it's using the SAKE data, a household survey where we have very detailed information about these households. This information is even merged with social security data, so we have very precise information about wages. Turned out to be very important for this project because it will be a project about the wage of foreigners that work in Switzerland, and they usually mix up before and after tax income, and just looking at what they report as their income, it's extremely noisy, and we couldn't find any effects, and now having the true information from Social Security, we actually see the effects that we were interested in. So here it's actually administrative data turned out to be very important. We do not have the big Scandinavian universe of data. So we also need tax rates, and again, that's from the same source of data. What we use as a method in the main exercise is a fuzzy regression discontinuity design, and what we exploit here is a special tax regime for foreigners in Switzerland. So let me quickly explain what the issue is here. So if you are a worker from abroad working in Switzerland, during the first 5 years in this country, you are facing a special tax regime. It's called a Quellensteuer. And the reason for that is, I mean, Swiss residents, they file for their taxes a year after they get the wage, and they submit the tax declaration, and then they get an invoice, and then they pay that. And we don't trust foreigners to actually be able to pay that. They might have left the country already, or they might not have saved the money. And in order to avoid such problems, we deduct it from their wage, as it is usually done in the countries where they are from. So that's a Quellensteuer. That was the reason why it's introduced, but that's not yet what we are exploiting. Now, to make it easier for Swiss administration to do that, we are not applying these municipal differences, so it's just a cantonal tax rate. So foreigners in Switzerland, they actually face a completely flat tax landscape within the canton. So all these differences, that there is a Speckgürtel, there are low tax municipalities and so on, they don't see that, they don't face that, they don't get the advantages from these low tax places. This, by the way, is only if you have an income below 120,000. So there is different discontinuities that we're going to exploit. One is 120,000 and above, that's a control and a treatment group, but the other one is after 5 years, we start trusting you. You are taxed like a Swiss resident, and you get these differences from the local tax rates. And these are the results that I'm going to show you as actually what's going on after these 5 years. So one way of showing that is, or looking at that is, we look here at the probability of households to move away from a municipality, and we look at that based on time since arrival in Switzerland. So this is only losing these foreign workers with an income below 120,000 who are during their first 5 years subject to this special tax regime. So what you see is actually, well, they arrive at some place, they're not too mobile, mobility even goes down, but then after 5 years, something dramatic happens, they become taxed as a Swiss resident. Now, the graph that I show you here, this is just a subsample of those living in a high-tax municipality. They haven't really faced that. They didn't pay the high taxes because they had the cantonal average, but after 5 years, all of a sudden, their tax rate jumps up. So what are they doing? They're moving out. So these probabilities actually almost triple at this point. So a dramatic change. You could actually think they could have anticipated that, but it seems to be that it really takes the invoice for them to react. Now, if at this point you don't really believe, yeah, well, after 5 years, other things actually happen, it's also they get the permit C, so they have maybe then a more long-term perspective. Let's compare that with those people that happen to live in a low-tax municipality. So after 5 years, their tax rate actually goes down. There's no reaction whatsoever for these people. They just realize, oh, I'm in a good place. And we can actually now use this to do a diff to compare these two reactions to get an idea of how important the migration response is as a reaction to increases in tax rates. So that's another piece of evidence or another example of how we exploit this rich variation in institutions and this rich data that we collected to get an answer to behavioral questions. Okay, example number three. Taxing wealth, evidence from Switzerland. That's a joint project with Marius Brühlhardt, John Gruber from the MIT, Matthias Krupp, who is a postdoc within the project in Lausanne, and myself. So what was the question here? That was the basic question on elasticities, but we're looking at the very special tax. At the moment, the world is extremely interested in this taxation. It's the taxation of wealth. So Switzerland is one of the few countries where you actually tax wealth. Net wealth, we only do that at the cantons and the municipality, providing us a lot of variation. And we're just looking whether this tax base, the net wealth of people, responds to changes in local wealth tax levels. So again, we are using data from this project, which is tax rates that we collected in this project. We also use data on tax bases, and we use here aggregate taxable wealth from 2003 to 2012. Now, unfortunately, this is data from the Federal Tax Administration. We do not have individual data. We have access to the individual tax records going back to 1972, but wealth is not part of that. And the reason is the Federation does not tax wealth, so they don't need to know that. Since 2003, they still have the aggregate information. Why is that? Because the National Tax Equalization Schemes needs that as an input to calculate these transfers. So the cantons have to report aggregate wealth levels. So we have some information on that, but it's not individual level. So we also wanted information on individual level, so we got access to just one canton, which is the canton of Bern, which provided us access to individual tax records of taxpayers in the canton of Bern, and we can follow up these people when they move within the canton. So there's much less variation that we can exploit there, but there is some, and we can see whether that actually matches our results from the aggregate and whether we can actually find the margins. Okay. What we do here is, this is a more traditional approach. We do panel regressions, but still we do use fixed effect. So in the end, it's a diff strategy. We also use cantonal linear time trends, and you will see there are more and many projects I'm going to show you here using these fixed effects, diff cantonal linear time trends. This is the basic result from using the aggregate results across the cantons, 10-year time window. So some cantons increased the wealth tax, some cantons reduced the wealth tax. What is the response of the net wealth in these cantons? What you see here is a semi-elasticity. So if the wealth tax rate, the marginal wealth tax rate, goes up by 1 percentage point, then actually the wealth tax base goes down by 34%. Looks like a huge response. However, wealth tax rates are never in the range of a percentage. So they're much smaller, they're 0.5%, 0.4%. So this is a huge increase. So if you look at like a reasonable increase of 1.1%, so that reaction would be 3.4%, and now we are in a credible range. We can also do a back of the envelope calculation to get elasticities from that. One of the elasticities that we can actually calculate is a tax rate elasticity. So if the tax rate goes up by 1%, what happens to the tax base? We got a minus 0.1 1.8, meaning this is a rather large elasticity. However, it's far to the left in the Laffer curve, so you could not make the argument decrease the tax rate on wealth. There is so much increase in the tax base that it actually, that it's more than what you lose from reducing the tax rate. No, you're on the left. So for a policy advice, this is not how you can actually increase revenue, but it's a rather small behavioral response. However, if you really want to compare behavioral responses, maybe the better thing is to look at keep rates and to look at keep rates comparing that to what would happen with income. So what we did here is we calculated, well, the wealth tax rate can be understood as a income tax on a hypothetical return from your net wealth. Assuming a 6% rate of return on wealth, actually this translates into a keep rate elasticity, and you put that on top of the federal income tax rate, federal, cantonal, municipal income tax rate, you get an elasticity of 1.16, which is a very large elasticity, telling you that actually the response that we observe here from wealth taxpayers in Switzerland is behaviorally a quite large response. Okay, so that's another paper that we did using exploiting the variation and the data. Let's look at time, good. Paper number 4, so now I stop contributing. This is a paper by Marius Brühlhardt and Raphael Parche, published at JPB 2014. Very nice title, Elects Tax Competition, the Mysterious Death of Bequest Taxes in Switzerland. Bequest taxes are inheritance taxes. So what we've seen in Switzerland is actually that there was a series of cantons that abolished inheritance taxes, and now only very few cantons actually tax inheritance. And the usual argument, if you go to newspaper, was like, we have to abolish that tax rate because taxpayers are extremely mobile. If we don't do that, our neighbor has abolished it. They all move to the neighboring canton. So it was a sense that the migration response is extremely high. So by not following your neighbor, you will actually also get nothing because the people are just leaving, and then you even lose the income tax when these people are still alive. So this paper actually tried to see whether that's really true. Are people towards the end of their life really very mobile and responding to inheritance tax rate? The data that they use is also these individual tax records from Bern, and actually that allowed them to calculate the tax base for the relevant population here, which are retired people, those who are potentially going to bequest at some point soon. So they collect that tax base, calculate that tax base from our individual tax records, 1973 to 2008. They also need data on the inheritance tax rates, also from our big database on tax rates on the cantonal and municipal level. They also use, and this is interesting now, at some point in the paper, what you need is actually a cross or a joint distribution of income and wealth. And as we do not have wealth in the individual records in Bern, they went for data from the Canton de Vaud, where they have access to individual records where you have wealth and income, and then you can do a cross-tabulation, so you know actually what kind of income and wealth do people, retired people, have. The method again, fixed effects, panel regression, diff and diff with cantonal linear time trends. And this is a way of summarizing, nicely summarizing actually the results. This is not dated. This is actually showing residuals after controlling for cantonal and year fixed effects. And they're looking in particular at reforms. So what happens when you abolish the bequest tax before and after? Now what you have here in the first graph is actually the tax base. How does this respond? So if the story is true that people are extremely mobile, and abolishing the tax rate should actually increase your tax base relative to what happens in other cantons. And when you look at that, is actually you see a zero response at this taxable income that you have from retired people. The second answer, which is the more policy relevant question, is like, so what happens actually to the tax revenue? Well, it falls because you don't have the tax revenue from these people, but it could actually go up because there is an in-migration now because you're more attractive, and then there could be a rebound effect, and you actually don't see any of such rebound effect. So abolishing the bequest tax had a simple effect. It reduced your tax revenue, but it didn't change much else. Okay, so that's example number four. This is now not looking at behavioral responses of people, but we're now looking at the jurisdiction and how what they are doing. So this is a paper by Beatrix Eugster and Raphael Parche, and it tries to identify whether municipalities react to one another if one municipality changes their tax level. And this is a paper that has a very smart identification strategy and exploiting actually institutional variation in Switzerland in a very clever way, but it will take a little bit of time to show you what they are doing. In terms of data, this is again municipal tax rate that we are exploiting. Also data on voting results to actually get an idea of the political situation in municipalities and its referenda on the federal level. So that gives us a comparable idea of how left-wing or right-wing a municipality is. So what they're doing is actually they're exploiting now the fact that in Switzerland, in three cantons, we have a language border within a canton. So they face all these municipalities around this language border. They face the same institution. They are part of the same canton. So this is Bern, Fribourg, and Valais. But they have a big difference, which is language. And behind language, there could be something like culture. And one of the differences is actually that tends to be in Switzerland that the French-speaking areas, they're a little bit more left-wing, a little bit more towards spending more money and finding public expenditures more valuable. And what you see here in this graph is exactly this. So what you see here is distance to the language border, only looking at these borders within cantons where you have a change in the language. As you go to the right, you go more towards the French part, to the left to the German speaking part, and you clearly see here, if you look at the results from federal referendum, on the French side, they're more left-wing. On the left side, they're more right-wing. And you would actually expect, if there is no tax competition whatsoever going on, that they vote for higher taxes and for more public expenditures. And so you should actually see on the right side higher tax rates than on the left side. And this is the next graph that shows you tax rates here. And what you see is actually, well, on average, that's true if you are quite far away from this border. However, if you're a municipality at the border and you face a neighbor here, if you're French-speaking, that has low taxes, this affects on what you can do. Actually, if you have these high taxes that you would actually like to have because of your cultural background, people might not live in your municipality anymore. They might move to the left side. And because you want to avoid that, you see that towards the border, language border, these municipalities, these tax rates, they converge. And that's kind of a nice evidence or piece of evidence that there seems to be reaction from these municipalities to the other municipalities, which is really a reaction to the tax rate and not other underlying common factors. Okay, so that's example number five, which uses a smarter identification strategy to find effects. A very similar paper in terms of the question is single authored by Raphael Parche, are local tax rates strategic complements or strategic substitutes? Similar questions. So do municipalities react to changes in neighboring municipalities? This is a question that has been approached in the literature, in the empirical literature for a long time. It's an extremely hard empirical question because, well, if you regress your tax rate on your neighbor's tax rate, this is endogenous because your neighbor's tax rate reacts to your tax rate. So this is a reverse causality by construction. It's very hard to actually estimate that properly. And then the second problem is, if your neighbor, well, your neighbor, so he is spatially close, so there might be some factors driving actually both municipalities in the same way. So if you actually observe that two municipalities close to one another are doing the same thing, it could be because they react to one another or because the same underlying forces are actually doing the same things to the two. So the idea here is, from Raphael, is to exploit, again, institutional variation in a clever way. And what he's doing is he's looking at the border between cantons, but he's looking at the municipalities. So you look at the border between two cantons, the municipalities at the border, and then you see whether they react to the municipalities on the other side of the border. Now that would not yet help, but what he's doing is he's doing an instrumental variable approach, not just using the change in the tax rate of these municipalities, but the change induced by a cantonal tax reform. So if the canton decides to increase or reduce taxes, all the municipalities in this canton are affected, also the one at the border. And this is a change which is not affecting by what's going on locally. So this is actually cannot be the reason that there is something underlying happening to both sides of the border. It only happens to one side of the border. So you can use this as an instrument to instrument the change in your local tax rate, and then you see how the municipality at the other side of the cantonal border reacts to that. Now let's see what he gets from that. The first part is actually just to show what we would get if you would do the traditional approaches, regressing tax rates on neighbors' tax rate, and you see a very significant positive effect. So if your neighbor increases taxes, you're also going to increase your tax rates. This is now, for all municipalities, a large sample, and now we restrict that just to these border municipalities, and what you see, that doesn't change a thing. So these border municipalities, they're actually the same as the rest of Swiss municipalities. Now, column number three does something that the literature has already introduced. There is an IV strategy to actually try to circumvent these endogeneity problems, but that's kind of mechanically done. And what you see, well, the effect even gets more positive. Now, the next column that I'm going to show you now is exploiting this instrument, which is much more convincing, by just looking at the variation that comes from cantonal tax changes. And what you see, this totally changes the picture, so we get a negative effect of about the same magnitude. So, smart identification strategy, and the answer is totally opposite, and it's also something that you might not have expected. So you would think, okay, your neighbor is reducing tax rates now, you also have to do that, and we get exactly the opposite result. What could be like a theoretical explanation why this makes sense? Well, imagine that you are a municipality, your neighbor dramatically reduces taxes, and then some of your tax base actually moves there. You lose money. So what can you do now? You have your public expenditures and you want to keep your level of expenditures, you have to increase taxes to keep your level of expenditures. So if actually these local jurisdictions are trying to keep their level of expenditure, this is exactly the reaction that you might expect. Now we could apply that to the political discussion in some places in Switzerland where I am very interested in right now. The canton of Basel-Land has this problem. Canton of Basel-Stadt has quite dramatically decreased tax rates because we can afford that, because we have corporate income taxes, which are very high from a pharmaceutical industry, which is doing extremely well at the moment. So we reduce taxes. The Speckgürtel that used to be the Speckgürtel all of a sudden had higher taxes than the center. So now what shall they do? People are moving to the center. They could reduce their tax rates. They already have budget deficits. Or they could increase it, but then they would even lose more of the population. A very tricky situation, but actually this number would say that municipalities would actually now go for, at least in the short run, increasing their tax rates. Okay, example number six. Now let's go to the next one. And that's a tough one. Does tax competition tame the Leviathan? Very nice title again, Marius Brühlhardt and Mario Schametti, 2016, a working paper. The question is a more fundamental one. Is tax competition good or bad? you could think it's good, actually, if you think, governments actually want to spend too much anyway, and tax competition constrains what they can do. So tax competition is good because it lowers tax rates and limits wasteful expenditures. But you could also have a view that actually tax competition is bad, this race to the bottom. It prevents jurisdiction to provide the local public goods which are necessary. Then it would be bad. Now, this paper tried to actually find evidence whether the one or the other is going on, and now really have to try. This is a subtle argument. It's not so easy to get that across in a minute. I will try to convince you that this graph shows you what's going on. So this is not data. What it shows is actually just a visualization of the regressions, which is, again, fixed effects, panel data, cantonal time trends, a visualization of the effect. Now, important here is there's an interaction here of the smallness of a municipality, and if this variable or this index is larger, that means there is more tax competition because there are more small units competing for tax base. And that's interacted by whether there is direct democracy in these places. So if there is direct democracy, you can actually say whatever the government wants to do, the population can overrule that anyway. But there are some places where there is not much direct democracy when it comes to setting tax rate. So the lower line actually tells you the situation if there is a lot of direct democracy, and you see this interaction that slopes up, meaning as tax competition increases, tax rates even go up. That's actually evidence that there is more vertical tax competition going on, and this is not the situation where you want to tame the bad government, the Leviathan. Now, the top line actually shows you the situation where there is not a lot of direct democratic control. You see, it's exactly the opposite effect. That actually now you're in a situation where increasing competition reduces the tax rate, and that tends to go more towards what people really want to. So it seems to be that it depends on the institution. So if you don't have direct democratic institution that prevent the government from spending too much, tax competition is a way of limiting that. However, if you do have these direct democratic institutions, there is no need for tax competition to take that role. Good. Last paper, just to show you a little bit that we are tackling very different questions, Patricia Funk and Christine. Oh, Christina. This is Freudian. Okay, Christina Gartmann, 2013. This is now also to show we have more data going back. So Patricia and Christina here went back using data from 1819, and they look at cantonal expenditures and revenue, and they want to see how a particular institution influences that, and the particular institution is proportional representation in cantonal parliaments. So we had lots of reforms over this time period that cantonal parliament, they moved from majoritarian rule to proportional rule, and there are theoretical explanations why this should actually change the politics in these cantons. And the results that you can see here is, if you just look at total expenditures, there's nothing going on if you change from majoritarian rule to proportional representation. There is no effect on expenditures, no effect on revenue. But very interestingly, if you look on what this money is spent on, you see very clear effect. There is a shift away from roads and agriculture, more these special interest spendings, that you would have more on the majoritarian rule towards education and welfare. So this is a very interesting result to see how institution can actually shape the outcome of politics. Good, so let me just wrap up. We actually think that this output that I've just shown you and what we produced over the last 6 years, that's just the beginning of an exciting journey. And actually, we think the more interesting question and hopefully the more interesting answers are just ahead of us. And we have lots of ideas what we could do. And actually, if you've been, well, if you've been to sessions here, you see lots of these ideas have already been people have started to work on that. So one way of going forward is to study the role of other fiscal and political institutions. So one could, for example, and this is very interesting, gather data on fiscal equalization schemes, on mergers of local jurisdictions like municipalities, and what this produces for the tax rates, for the tax base. And there was a very nice paper by Florian Chatigny and Marco Kurtenburger yesterday that was exactly looking at that, using the data from this project. We could also identify and exploit more quasi-experimental changes. So this is, for example, the paper by Isabel Martinez, who looked at Obwalden, which has this dramatic reform in the tax rates for top incomes, and to do this event study type of research. One could also look at other response margins, for example, why not looking at how retirement saving reacts to tax variation? And that's a nice paper that Alma Ramsden, which is a joint work with Monica Butler, that she presented yesterday, again, using this tax data that we collected in this research project. We also want to enlarge the time frame. So going back to World War II, Raphael Parshad is at the moment working right on that. This is not just interesting because it's more data point, but because actually one of the most exciting questions is like, when did tax havens in Switzerland really emerge? That was before 1970s. So the really rise of Zug and Schweiz actually happened before the data that we have at the moment. And we hope that very soon we can really look at that in our data. We also want to enlarge the scope of the data when it comes to tax rates. So we have yet very few data on corporate taxation. But there is a lot of very interesting things going on also in politics at the moment when it comes to firm taxation. But this is also a lot of work, actually firm taxation and lots of institutional detail, which are very hard to capture, but we're working on that too. And then the last point, and I think that's very important, we have done tremendous improvement when it comes to empirical work in terms of the methods that we're using, the data that we have, but we are lacking in most of these projects the theoretical foundation, because the theory that really describes what's going on in a country with the institution like Switzerland does not yet exist, and we need more people who actually work on that theory, and that would also be very helpful then to get actually even better estimates, which are more structural and in the end, maybe also welfare effects. Is this whole situation good or bad for the country? Thank you very much.
Thank you for the very nice talk. I have first a very simple question. I guess you didn't include all the foreigners who pay flat rates or can negotiate how much they pay. No, you only have the people who really. Yes.
This is now the specific project on foreign taxation, or in general when we look at the data. So that's the.
No, it's just an important information, because if you would include those people, then certainly on slide 19, the curve would drop much, much, much more than it does now, if you would include those people.
That's right, they're not included here. Yes.
So that's an important information.
I mean, and the problem here is also like on the horizontal axis, you would actually really want to know what they're, well, whether the taxable income, which is reported, which is not their real income. I mean, this is a group of people which is difficult to deal with. Okay. But the thing is, we don't have data because the cantons and the federal administration, they're very careful with these data. That's extremely confidential.
I think even better, because there you know exactly to which direction the bias goes. But then this includes also the second question, because these are people who just immigrate to Switzerland because they have here a flat rate or can negotiate. But that would mean that you could say we don't suppose that internal tax competition between the municipalities would cause an out-migration out of Switzerland. And that allows you to calculate how much Switzerland as a whole is losing from tax income due to the internal tax competition. And this would be also very interesting. Okay, after that you can always say, well, all the tax income we are losing, they would have wasted anyway, okay, but that's a different question. But thanks to having excluded those cases, you could do that. It's very interesting because on an international level, we know that tax competition between states is one of the biggest drivers of poverty and inequality.
That's an interesting statement, so we have to discuss that, where that, what that is based on. Yeah, thank you very much.